Hello and welcome to Vishwarang 2020, the Tagore International Literature and Arts Festival organized by the Rabindranath Tagore University, Bhopal. My name is Siddharth Chaturvedi and I welcome you all to this session as the co-director of the Vishwarang Festival. Vishwarang is one of the biggest celebration of Indian literature, arts, culture, cinema and music virtually at the global stage. The festival goes truly global this year, with 16 countries joining hands and celebrating the essence of Indian culture across the globe. Today, we have an exciting session lined up in front of us. We are in conversation with Sudha Menon, an author, journalist, columnist, fiction and non-fiction writer, creative writing coach, and a motivational speaker, whose work has earned several acclaims over the past years. I will leave the rest of the introduction for our moderator. Welcome to Vishwarang, Sudha ji.
Lovely being here. Thanks for having me over.
Thank you. And in addition to moderate the session today, we have with us Dr. Sulabha Dixit, who is a yoga teacher as well as an assistant professor of the English language. With an avid interest in the fields of arts, literature, and education, she is also an active member of the Club Literati of Bhopal since its inception. So, welcome to the session, Sulabha ji.
Namaste.
Namaste.
I am really privileged to be here. Thank you, Siddharth, for having me here.
So, a very warm welcome once again to our speaker and to our moderator. And now, I hand over the session to our moderator. Looking forward to a very refreshing, a very exciting, very interactive session with the author, Sudha Menon.
Thank you. Thank you, Siddharth. So to call Sudha just an author, a columnist, and a motivational speaker would not suffice to describe the multifaceted personality that she has. She's a lady who wears many hats, and she has championed the cause of women and is often invited to educational institutes and corporate houses to speak on gender diversity and inclusion issues. She also has shed light on the misconceptions that we have about the so-called disabled section of society. And, you know, she not only writes, she speaks, she conducts workshops, she helps other people to write, she promotes her books and tours all over the country to do that, finds time for other people, helps people to mend their relationships, and also dabbles in theater to top it all. And her appeal spans a wide canvas, right from children to young adults to working professionals and even retired elderly people. So I think I feel really honored and privileged to be having this conversation with you, Sudha.
Thank you.
So now that the audience knows a little bit about what you do, why don't you tell us about your journey as a writer right from the beginning? What really motivated you? Yes, and let me tell everyone that before Sudha published her first book in 2010, she had been a journalist with the leading publication houses, with the leading newspapers for 25 years, you know? So it's amazing. It's been really amazing knowing Sudha, and I would like her to start from the very beginning. How or what influenced you to be a writer, Sudha?
Thanks for that introduction. I'm always embarrassed when somebody introduces me, because that is how, you know, that is really the seed of what happened to me. When I was a kid, I was one of the four children that my parents had, and I was a painfully shy kid, you know, totally shy, tongue-tied, almost friendless, because I was shy. I couldn't go out and make friends. And so I was friendless. And oftentimes when my siblings would be out playing with the friends or, you know, having a good time in school, I would actually, you know, once I came back from school, I would hardly ever go out. Not much, because I was shy. I didn't have friends. And so I chose to, or I had to stay at home. And the more I stayed at home, the more I reached for the bookshelf in our house, where my father had like hundreds of books, you know, and I would pick up a book and I would lose myself in the pages of that book. And the more I read, the more I loved the written word. And the more I found that a comfortable space to be in, I loved the world of books and words and characters that authors created. And slowly, but, you know, I don't even know how it happened, but slowly one day, suddenly, I started dreaming of having a book one day that would have my name on it, on the cover. And it was too audacious a dream for me at that point. We came from a very humble middle-class family. And also, like I said, I was painfully shy. So I don't know. I didn't know whether this was a dream that could even be shared with anybody, because how would a child with just maybe 1.5 friends become an author? So I never told this dream to anybody. But the more I read, the more that dream, you know, sort of took shape inside me. And then I think somehow in my subconscious it stayed. And when the time came for me, actually, when I, as I grew up and I became a teenager, and then I took up arts, you know, I was doing my BA. And on the last day of my BA class, I told my mother that I know that you want me to pick up a job, maybe in a nationalized bank. Or she dreamt that I would work for the railways, because my father is a railwayman. But I told her, you know, Amma, I don't really want to do any of this. I want to write. And it was tough times for us those days. And I knew that my parents expected or hoped that the children would pick up jobs and then, you know, the family would be all right and we would be financially better. My father was a trade union leader, a very honest trade union leader, so which meant that my family did not have really too much to live on, because he gave away most of what he earned to poor people. And so this job would have been important for my family. But the moment I told my mother that this is my dream, I want to write. And at that point, I had no idea ever that I would become an author. At that point, I just wanted to start writing. And so without even blinking, my mother said, I don't know what that will entail, but whatever it entails, your dream should come true. And so, you know, at 19 or 20, I left Mumbai. I think it was a big thing for my family at that point to, you know, find the money to sort of send me out of the city to study journalism. And within a year and a half, I had cleared. I was a gold medalist that year in journalism school. And yes, that was the beginning of my journey as a writer. You know, I discovered myself as a writer. I found everything that I did not have when I was a teenager. You know, I found a voice. I found confidence, and I found that when you are confident and when you're able to meet people's eye and have a conversation with them, they respect you. They respect you for taking a stand. They respect you for having an opinion. And slowly but surely, you know, my dream of becoming a writer started. And like you said, 25 years of it, I had the rare opportunity of working with some of the most reputed publications in the country at that point, and also some fantastic editors from who I learned so much, you know. And in those days, journalism was much different than what it was now. Journalism had conviction, journalism had an opinion, they stood up for what is true. It was not what it is now. And so I consider myself very, very lucky to have been a writer in those times. Yeah, so that was the beginning of my journey.
So that's lovely. So I think the seed of it was sown through your reading. So everyone who wants to be a writer should first be a reader, don't you think? So
100%. My number one tip, actually, for people who want to write, you know, I've been holding my writing workshops in India for the last 10 years or more. I started that at a time when it was unheard of, but I wanted to do that. I wanted to teach people how to write. And my number one tip for anybody who comes to my writing workshop is that if you want to be a good writer, you have to be a good reader. Learn to read, consume books, eat books for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And only then should you hope to be a good writer.
So how did this switch from journalism to becoming an author happen?
Okay, that's actually a long story in terms of time, because I did about 25 years of journalism and switched different publications, did everything from covering labor movement, women's issues, politics, to gender relations, you know, everything. And by the end of maybe the 23rd, 24th year of my journalism career, I was almost sleepwalking through my journalism days. So I'd wake up in the morning, I still wanted to be the best journalist there was, still have my exclusive stories on the front page of a newspaper. But somewhere in the back of my mind was this realization that I'm not satisfied. I'm like hungering to do something which would challenge me, because this was already done. I knew I could write a story without even applying my mind to it. You know, when I say story, I mean a new story. And I didn't want it like that. I wanted for me to wake up every morning hungry to do something new. And so I decided that this is it. And if I don't take the leap now, I'm never going to sort of do it. And so almost at my 25th year in journalism, or the 24th, I decided one day that this was the time for me to start writing the books that I sort of always wanted to write. And it was frightening, you know, that first day after I resigned from my job, and I was working for a very, very prominent publication at that time. And the first day and the next few days was very frightening for me, because you wake up one morning and everything that you meant the world to you is not there anymore. You don't have a designation. You don't have a role. I woke up in the morning and I did not know what to do, because there was no news story to write, no reporting to anybody to be done, no going out to meet people. And the first few days, I think I drove everybody in my house around the bend. Till one day, my husband told me, look, you wanted to write a book. And so now you cannot worry about salary and money in the bank, or your designation as a journalist. Now is the time for you to write the books that you dreamt about. And this is the time, because there is really nothing else now. Your child has grown up and gone away. And so this is the time. And so I decided that I would write that book, that one book which had been forming in my mind for almost 10 years, you know, a book about how women do it all. As a business journalist, the last 10 years of my life, I would keep meeting all these fabulous, wonderful, successful women from across all sorts, you know, from across various segments of life, from all walks of life. And I would always wonder, what is it that they are doing that I'm not doing? What is it that gives them that edge? What is it unflappable, so much in charge of their lives, achieving so much, being able to maximize their time in this universe? What is it? I wanted to, and these are all really, you know, trend-setting women, path-breaking women, women who had done things in India where, you know, they had really nobody to look up to. They chose their own, they in fact made their own path. And so I said, I want to bring the stories of that, those women. I first want to learn from them, and then I want to bring their stories to other women like me, young women like me. I was in my 40s already, but I wanted this book, the stories of these women, to be a sort of guiding, a friendly guide, you know, or something to look up to as they chose to follow their dreams. And so Leading Ladies, my first book, Leading Ladies, Women Who Inspire India. It remains one of my most popular books, you know, and it was written, and I think it was because it was written with a heart full of hope. I was full of uncertainty, because it was not something that I'd done before, you know, write a book. But it was also a book written with so much passion because I really wanted to do this book, not just for me, but other women like me. And so it remains that this book continues to inspire people who read it, and women who read it actually, you know, write back to me and say that it actually did help them get clarity on their own lives.
So, no wonder your books are bestsellers. Not only write motivational material, but you also speak it, and your capacity to motivate and to inspire leadership has taken you and afforded you opportunities to speak from prestigious platforms like TEDx Pune, and you are speaking and motivating all the time. And when I look at your books, you have written so much about women. You have written a legacy, which are letters from eminent personalities, you know, eminent people, very famous people, to their daughters. And then you have written a book which is called Devi, Diva, She Devil, A Working Woman's Guide to Survival. And then your latest is Feisty at 50. And so would you say that your books are women-centric?
A large portion of, I think I'm preoccupied with the condition of women in this country. I'm preoccupied with the concerns of women in this country. And I think it's also because I grew up and I was in a profession where there were far too little women when I started out. And somewhere, you know, as a woman who was on the job, on the ground every day, meeting women on the job, I was always sort of aware of the things that happen to women, you know, women who dream, especially, and even any woman who wants to do something but is not able to do whatever she wants to do because of various circumstances. So I always thought that I have the, you know what they say about the power of the pen. And I said, I have this power. I have the power to put ideas in words and present it to the world. And if I have that power, why can't I use it to change, the conditions for women? After all, you know, even if it is a cliche, this cliche is something that is reality, that we do hold up half the universe and then we don't sort of get what we are meant to get. We don't get what we deserve. So I said, let me use my words to write books that will make an impact on their lives, change perceptions, change mindsets, give them hope and give them motivation. So yes, my books, a large part of my books are women-centric, subconsciously, it was not deliberately, but I think subconsciously, I tend to write books like that. For instance, Legacy, when I wrote Legacy is a book of letters. When I wrote Legacy, when the idea of Legacy came into my mind, my daughter was turning 21 that year. And I wanted to write a letter to her to tell her, you know, what are the things that she should cultivate, the habits, the attitudes, the behaviors, whatever it is that a woman needs to live a life of dignity and fulfillment, you know. And then I started writing that letter, and then I said, you know how it is with parents and children, that the moment a parent says something, it's sort of bhashan, you know, it's not, mom, don't give me a lecture. You know? So I said, instead of me writing this letter, why can't I just get some of this country's biggest minds, the most admired and accomplished people, why don't I talk to them, interview them, and find out from them, what are their dreams for their daughters? What is it that they want to tell their daughters? You know, what do they want to tell their daughters is important for a woman to know, you know, so that she lives a life of which she is, she gets to choose the life she wants. So what are the behavioral, the skills, the attitudes, or whatever things that she needs to know so that she is in charge of her life? And so I set out on this journey and I met some remarkable people talking to me about their daughters. And based on their conversations with me, I wrote letters on their behalf to their daughters. And it's a wonderful book because I realized that, you know, there is everybody there. There is Mr. Narayanamurthy who met me, I think, when I wrote to him, he said, okay, I can meet you for 20 minutes. And I live in Pune and he lives in Bangalore. And I said, I'm happy with 20 minutes, I'll come. And I went there and I think it was 2 days before his son was to get married. But I met him and I think that conversation went on for over an hour, because that is the nature of a father's relationship with his daughter. He was so lost in that conversation that finally there had to be a call from somebody in the family saying that you have to come back to the wedding preparations. And I remember how, you know, one of the things that he told me, remember, he's one of India's biggest, you know, business people, entrepreneurs,
of course,
Infosys. But I remember what he told me. He said, you know, the day my wife gave birth and I held her in my hands, I held my little daughter in my hand, he says that the day I set my eyes on you, the day I first held you in my arms, my entire world changed. And I realized that from now on, from this day on, I'm going to be a different person. I'm going to be a person who, when you grow up, you will look up to and be proud of. He says that changed my equation with the world, with every person I interacted, because I wanted my daughter to be proud of me. So it was a very sentimental journey for me, but it was also a great sort of learning experience, because one of the things I learned was that no matter who you are and no matter how much money you have in your bank, the concerns that we have as human beings are all the same. You know, you worry about your parents, you want the best for your children, you want to lead an honest life. You know, these are at the core of every human being's life. And I realized that no matter who you are, it is what drives you every day. So that book was really special, yes.
That was a very heartwarming story, Sudha. It's really beautiful. And it's amazing how you have used circumstances of your own life to connect with other people and to motivate them through this beautiful connection. Because yes, you are right. All of us as human beings have the same journey to a certain extent. Absolutely. And your latest book, Feisty at 50, is autofiction, where you have, so was it difficult to bear yourself, your private life, to be, you know, sort of viewed by your readers? Because yes, there is this, because you write nonfiction, a lot of your life is reflected in your writings. And so tell us about, yeah, what a beautiful looking book too.
I'm very, very proud of this book. I'm extremely proud of this book, because when I take my writing workshops, I say that one of the most important things for a writer to do is to be honest and to be able to put all their vulnerabilities out in the open, you know, right? I think you can only write or do your best work when you are able to talk about everything in your life with honesty. You know, you cannot write something with conviction if you're hiding behind things. And so when I wrote Feisty at 50, I wrote it because for a whole lot of reasons, but I also, writing Feisty at 50, in fact, liberated me in a way nothing else has. You know, I wrote this book because I turned 50, you know, when I wrote that book, I was already 51 or reaching 52, but it had been bothering me, you know, that we live in a society which is so ageist. You know, from the time I entered my 40s, there would always be this, you know how society is, the people around you, they will make you feel sort of not good enough anymore or not worth a lot anymore because, oh, you know, you're 40 or you're 45 or you're 50, you know, and it is everywhere. It is when you go to the mall to buy clothes, some salesperson there will say, ki ye aapke umar ke liye nahi hai. You try to buy a tube of red lipstick and a well-meaning salesperson will say that, ma'am, aapke age ke liye brown theek rahega. You know, why don't you wear brown or nude color? You know, red is for youngsters. and all sorts of things. People begin to imagine that you're not no longer, you're past your prime, you're down, you know, down the hill. And I was getting mad at this kind of messaging, because I at 54 today, I feel that I'm at my most empowered. You know, I feel that I'm able to do so much more with my life. In fact, I'm doing so much more with my life. And I'm wondering why I didn't think of all these things when I was in my 30s or 20s. But really, this is a message that I want to give everybody, and not just women, men too. I think there is something hugely empowering about hitting your 50s. You know, you're past the age when you have to impress anybody. You don't have, you've done all the things that you want to achieve. You have nothing to prove anymore. And so you just do what you want to do, what you have always wanted to do, but never did, because you have to raise the children. You had to earn a livelihood. You had to prove to the world that you're good and all of that. But yeah, so I said, I'm going to tell the world that I'm 50 plus and I'm having the time of my life. And that meant writing about a whole lot of things, a whole lot of relationships, a whole lot of situations and experiences that I've gone through in life. And I was fine by it. You know, I was just a wee bit concerned about would it sort of upset my family that I have put them all in the pages of a book. But, you know, if I have been around for the last 10 years and my family is used to me being an author and writing a lot of things, some of which they don't really agree with. But with this book, I was delighted that they all loved the book. In fact, my mother, who was going through a little sort of a down phase in her life, you know, she read the book, and there was one day when she came visiting me, and in the afternoon I was doing my work and I heard this giggling and laughing outside, and I went out and she was lolling on the sofa and reading my book, and she was having the time of her life. So that was hope giving for me, you know, that was so liberating, that it is, like I always say in life, I tend to be a kind of worrier. I used to be a kind of worrying kind, but having written this book now, I've learned to not take life so seriously. I think that we should all take ourselves with a pinch of salt. And yeah, so
that's wonderful.
It was not scary to write this book.
That's wonderful advice, Sudha. So I think turning 50 can afford all of us, everyone, in fact, another opportunity to be the best version of ourselves. Right?
100%, 100%. And I want anybody who's listening to this conversation, I hope that you read this book and really figure out that it is all okay. You know, you can be what you want. And if the world doesn't like it, just too bad. You still have to do what your heart tells you to do.
I'm sure many among our audience are aspiring writers. So it'll be wonderful if you could tell us a little bit about your writing process, and how different is it from your time as a journalist?
How different is it? I'll take that question first, because that was really where it began. So I think in the first year that I gave up journalism, I had to relearn everything I knew about writing. You know, while journalism had taught me to be, as a news journalist, I was told, be objective, be precise, be short, you know, use minimal words and finish an entire news story. So in a maximum of 200 words. That is exactly the opposite of writing a book. You know, while writing about the stories of the, especially because it's nonfiction, it's about people and it's about people who inspire me or various, you know, just real life stories. I had to put my heart out, actually. You know, I had to think with compassion. I had to think there has to be empathy in my, you know, when I listen to their stories. And a book is 60,000 words at the very minimum. And so from writing a news story in 200 words to writing a book at 60,000 words, it was a huge learning experience for me. Something I don't regret at all. You know, if somebody were to look into my back account today, there is very, very little to live on, because authors don't make any money. But in terms of return on the investment, in terms of time, and the fulfillment that I get, it is like 500%. So yes, so that was that. So the process of transformation, you know, changing from author, journalist to author was tough, but fulfilling. What is my process? So I think my process is like when I'm finishing one book, suddenly one day, gradually, even as I'm writing that first one book, there is an idea already forming inside, you know, somewhere in my head. And I don't allow it to sort of cloud what I'm doing at that point. But I know that this baby is developing in my head. And I, at night when I go to sleep, I always find it difficult to sleep because I have so many ideas in my head and those keep me awake. But at the day I press the send button on one manuscript to the publisher, I know that from the next day, my next baby is born. You know, what is my process? My process is, I believe that if you're a writer, you have to write every single day. And even if it is just 200 words, write it, write every day. And this is for everybody. Like you said, there are aspiring writers listening to this. Write every day, make writing a part of your everyday life. Don't think of it as something that is intimidating or something that is, you know, there are people I know, there are aspiring writers who I know who punish themselves by saying, I have to write 1,000 words every day. No, you know, don't make it to be a thing which will kill your spirit. Even if it is 200 words, write it, but do make it a habit to write every day. Read every day, read good books, read diverse topics, diverse sort of authors and subjects. But read every day, because if you won't read, you won't be able to learn from the masters, you know. So read every day, read a lot of good books, be interested in people. You know, writers get their life, you know, the lifeline for any writer is the lives of other people. You know, a lot of what people, authors write about is what they see and observe around them, you know. So be interested in people. Watch how they talk, listen to what they are saying, see how they are walking, talking, living, what is around you. Be interested, because if you are not interested in people, you are never going to be an interesting writer. So that is very important. And yes, there will be ups and downs, and there will be great lengths of, there will be weeks going by where you don't feel inspired or a word will not come out of you. But when that roadblock hits you, go out and have a good time. And when you're having a good time, still keep your eyes and ears open and listen. Because I always think that for a writer, you know, no interaction is wasted, because you're always going, your raw material is coming from all those interactions. So keep your eyes and ears open and learn new things at every opportunity, learn new things. Because somewhere, it might not be today, but 20 years later, in something that you write, one of those experiences from your younger days is going to turn up. So live life to the fullest. That is really important.
So stories are happening all around us all the time. Absolutely. And you talk about listening, watching, understanding. You talked about compassion and empathy. And that reminds me of the book you published in 2013 called Gifted. Yes. It's about people with disabilities. And yes. There are inspiring stories about people with disabilities there. I would like you to tell us about how that happened.
So, yes. So, Gifted was a book that I never set out to write. I was in Bangalore launching my book, Legacy. And one of the people who were kind enough to launch the book for me, we had a speakers panel, and one of the people I had invited to launch the book for me in Bangalore was this wonderful human being and a very dear friend of mine called V.R. Firoz. He was MD of SAP, the German company, SAP, at that point. And he came there and he listened to my stories about legacy. And legacy itself has a lot of parents talking about empathy and compassion and how you should have these human qualities. At the end of that event, Firoz told me, brilliant book. And then he said, I was wondering if you would be interested in writing about the lives of people with disability. Would you consider writing this book, co-authoring it with me? And I told him, you know, Firoz, I have not thought about it, but you talk about it with so much conviction, so I'm 100% on. So let's do this book. And writing legacy, writing Gifted was a kind of journey that completely transformed me in many, many ways. I had never actually come in close contact with anybody with disability, you know, till then. You know, I had a young boy who was my classmate, I think in grade 6, and he had polio. But after that, I don't think anybody in close contact at all. So I don't know how those lives are lived. I didn't know, like most of us, how many disabled people, you know, how many people with disability do you actually see in day-to-day life? These days, some more than what it used to be when I was growing up.
Right.
Because infrastructure is a wee bit better now than, you know, otherwise, you know, we kind of treat people with disability as, you know, they're largely on the fringes of our lives. You know, we have given them very little to live their lives, you know, even something as small as, even now it is a struggle for them to go to a movie or go to a stadium to watch a game of cricket because there are no ramps for their wheelchairs. It's such a simple thing, but we haven't done it. You know, there is a law in this country which requires that to be the basic thing that every building will have, but we still don't have it because we don't have empathy and we don't have compassion. So I started writing this book and I met some amazing men and women, you know, some of them with no limbs at all. You know, some of them who have never walked, somebody who just works a computer with just his little finger and is great, yeah, and is a brilliant worker in one of the top IT companies in this country. You know, a visually, impaired girl of 25 who skydives and who's invited to speak in parliaments across the world, you know, to help governments set down their disability policies. So these are the kind of people I spoke with. Are you able to hear me?
Hello. Yes.
Hi.
So just give us a minute. I think she's logging back in. I'm getting her to log in.
No problem. It's going so well.
This is precisely why we were insisting that we do a recorded session. Yes. So
I'm happy with that. Yes. So yes. Is this going well? Is there anything else that you need? We are going good?
I think it's going on wonderfully, and we are covering all these points, and we've also covered the whole thing on aspiring writers and the process which should be. Hello.
Hi.
Yeah. So maybe just one more thing. If so, like the Narayan Murthy story you narrated, if there are one or two more real life experiences Absolutely. Or examples which you can cover in any of your Absolutely. Answers, that will be more interesting.
Lovely, lovely, lovely. I'll do that. Whenever she is ready, not to worry.
Yes.
Thanks. She's back there
again. It was such an interesting conversation, and suddenly
no, that's okay.
Lost connection. So you
no issues. Yeah, I mean it's going on very well. We can resume from the last point. Yes, thank you.
So I think Sudha, so you were telling us about Gifted.
Yes.
When we lost contact.
So like I said, so I set out on this journey speaking to this extraordinary people, and everywhere, like there was this story of Malati Hola. Malati Hola she has over 300 medals in Special Olympics and other special, sporting events, like global honors for this country. Malati Hola was, she had polio when she was 5 years old, and she was in a home for people with special needs for the better part of her childhood. But she refused to give up on her life. Her mother refused to give up on her life. And she came out of that special home. She went to college, and she educated herself, and then became this superstar in the special sporting events for this country, and got herself. She's a bank officer today in Bangalore, and it is amazing for me every time I meet her, because during the day, she's a bank officer, and she's the one who's giving loans to people and, conducting the affairs of the bank. And by night, she says, I have a begging bowl in my hand, because what she does is she runs something called the Matru Foundation. Through Matru Foundation, she has actually adopted, to date, she has about 25 children with severely deformed bodies or with various degrees of disability. She's mother to them. She's the matru to them. And she educates them. She has made a little home for them. She lives with them. And she says, all those experiences that I never had when I was a child, because I was disabled, I give to these children, and I educate them, and I learn, I teach them to fend for themselves and live life with honor and dignity. And to me, it is amazing. You know, she is now a bank officer. She could have chosen to say that I have a good life and I'm just going to be like this. But she says every evening I am with a begging bowl at some corporate house or some donor saying that, you know, I need to educate these children. So whatever you can do for me. So it is, these are the things that I learned, that there is a life that you can live of great dignity and great fulfillment, a life that is not just for yourself, but a life that you can do for somebody else too. Can you hear me?
We lost her again.
I can hear you.
Yeah. We lost
Sulbha.
Yeah.
We'll wait.
Welcome back, Sudha. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, I am.
Yeah. So let's go back to that wonderful story.
Yeah.
Of
So I was talking about the people that I met during the writing of Gifted, such as Malati Hola, who was stricken with polio when she was 5 or 6, and spent almost her entire childhood in a special home, where she says she actually had to fend for herself. You know, it was a home where there are people with varying degrees of disability. She did not lose her spirit. She taught herself to survive in the toughest circumstances. And when she came out of that school and went to college, educated herself, got herself employed in employment in a bank, at that point is when she showed that her disability was not a burden to her. Her disability was not a roadblock. What she actually did was spend the next few years of her life. Even today, when every time I meet Malathi, I'm, you know, struck with wonderment about how she does it. But well into her 40s now, Malathi Hola is the founder of something called the Matru Foundation, where she has actually adopted some 20 children from rural India who have varying degrees of disability. And she's mother to them. She looks after them, teaches them, you know, gives them every experience that she says she was deprived of because of her disability. She you know, she goes off every year with 20 of them to some distant place so that it's a sightseeing tour for them. And she goes by train. She teaches them how to handle all those situations. She educates them. She skills them. And for me, you know, these are the things that are eye-openers, and these are the things that I learned, that there is a life to be lived that is not just for your own selfish interest. You know, there is more to life than just living your life, buying the bigger, you know, a bigger car, a bigger home, more clothes, more jewelry. Malathi Hola could have done that with her life. You know, she is comfortably off with a job in a bank, but she chose to look at life with compassion, and she had empathy for others who had disability. And, you know, I met 30 people or more during the writing of Gifted, and each of them have, you know, inspired me, and each of them have taught me that we, with all our faculties and our organs and all our limbs intact, we are not living life to the fullest, while they have to live, they have to try 200% more than we do to get to the same place that we are, you know, and still they do it with a smile, they do it with happiness, and they find joy in the present. Okay, I think you're back now, yeah.
Yeah, so it's amazing that these people whom we call disabled are actually more able than us, isn't it? Especially able. You know, after listening to you, I truly understand why they deserve to be called specially abled. It's really inspiring. And it's amazing how, you know, listening to you, I feel that that cliche that life is stranger than fiction is actually true. Because,
you know, when I meet these people, when I meet all the friends that I want to tell you the story of, you know, Harsh, Hans Dalal, who is one of the people I have written about in the book. Hans has cerebral palsy, and from his childhood, and he's now, you know, in his late 20s or so. But Hans, when he was a kid, because of his cerebral palsy, he cannot stand in one place. So he's like, he looks to others like, can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Now I can.
Yeah. So Hans Dalal was
You might have to repeat.
So I was talking to you about the story of Hans Dalal, who is another hero from my book, Gifted. And Hans grew up with cerebral palsy and, you know, very severely disabled. And but he told his parents, I want to go abroad and I want to learn sound engineering. So he hooked off to Australia to learn sound engineering. Then he came back and then he started working in that sector. And then one time his uncle took him to see a tiger. He says, the first time I saw a tiger in the wild, I was sold on that. I was mesmerized and I wanted to spend my entire life being in close proximity to nature. And so Hans, who had set up his business in Bombay and all of that, 3 years ago, Hans shifted lock, stock and barrel to Tadoba National Park in Nagpur. He lives there now, by the forest. He lives there now by the forest. He is a trained naturalist and a tiger tracker. So when people, the officials in the tiger park, they actually employ him to track tigers, to know the movement of tigers in the park. He actually works with the tribals in that village, you know, in the nearby villages. He teaches them skills so that they don't then go and poach the tigers in the forest. He says that wow. You have taken away their livelihood. And so they do what they think will keep them alive, you know. So these are the things that Hans Dalal does. And he, you know, he has cerebral palsy. The world thinks he's disabled. But I say that he is more able than all of us. You should hear his TED Talks. You know, when he talks on the TED platform, you have to listen to his story. It is one of the most inspiring stories I have ever heard. And to see this man who can barely control his bodily movements because of cerebral palsy, he stands on that TED platform and talks about his life and his journey with the tiger with such conviction. And these are the heroes that. These are heroes for me, you know, not Bollywood stars, not anybody else. These are the people, real life people who inspire me. And that is why I write nonfiction, you know, because I really think that there is so much in life that you can learn in real life that I'm often asked, why don't you write nonfiction? You know, there is money in nonfiction. And I say that I'm not writing for money. I'm writing because it fulfills a need in me. And I'm writing because the kind of writing I do brings me in proximity with people who inspire and motivate me, people who make me want to be a better person, somebody that somebody else can look up to, you know, that's why nonfiction. Like one of the most inspiring things, experiences that I've had in my life in the recent years has been my meeting with our boxing champion, Mary Kom. And, you know, little woman, petite, and if you pass by her on the road, and if you don't know who she is, she would just be taken as, you know, just somebody else. Yeah, just some ordinary Indian, you know, doing his or her everyday living. I met Mary when she was training in Pune for the Rio Olympics. And that was the time I was writing my book, Devi Diva or She Devil. And that book is really actually, I actually called it A Career Woman's Survival Guide, because I think as a woman who's ambitious and who wants to do something in her career, but still wants to do everything else in life with the same sort of commitment and passion, we all need a survival guide. You know, what do we do? How do we straddle these challenges? How do we straddle all our roles? So I started meeting women who kind of inspire me, and I wanted them to tell me what they do. How do they survive all the things that a woman has to survive? And I met Mary the sports, there is a training center in the outskirts of Pune. So I'd go in the evening there, and she would come back after a full day's practice in the boxing ring. And then she would come straight to meet me in the coffee shop. And we would talk, her children were around, little children, but they knew that mama is in work mode, so they wouldn't come and disturb us. They would just be on the side with the nanny while Mary talked to me. And I still remember what Mary once told me. You know, one of the conversations was about how she became a boxer at a time when India had no boxers at all. Women boxers were like unheard of. But she said that when I started living in, she grew up in a very poor household, in a very poor small village. And she says, you know, in Manipur. And then she said to me that at every stage in my life, there have been people who have told me, you cannot do that. You know, when I first started boxing, or when I first started telling people that I wanted to box, she was still a little girl then. They said, but you're a girl, you can never become a boxer. And then she says, I would tell them, look, can you see me working in the field, shoulder to shoulder with my father? I'm doing that so that my father can put food on the table for all of us. So if I can do that, if I can do what a man can do in a field, I can do what a man can do in the boxing ring as well. And they would laugh at her. Then slowly she started becoming a good boxer. And then she started getting a name for herself in the boxing ring, you know, state level, district level, state level. And then they said that, no, but you know, nobody will marry you because you're a woman and you're a boxer. And which man is going to marry a woman who's a boxer? And, you know, and you'll never have a normal life like other women have. And she says that I kept quiet because I knew my dream and I was not going to argue. And then she says that I married my best friend, Onlar Karam, who she says is her closest and biggest supporter to this day. She said, when I married him and I went first to live in his village, she says almost the entire village boycotted me because they couldn't understand how a woman can be this successful person, a woman from their village, from, you know, from a small village, from their community. How could she have all of this and still, you know, live life on her terms? And she says, everybody sort of stopped talking to me or they didn't include me. And she says, I was so miserable that I would often tell my husband, I'm going to give up. I don't want to be a boxer. You know, I don't, at this cost, I don't want to be a boxer. She says, my husband and my father-in-law would tell me every morning, your job is to not listen to all these naysayers, all these people who are pulling you down. Your job is to get up in the morning, go to the boxing ring and bring laurels for yourself and for your country. And she says, that gave me hope. Wow. She says, then they said, you will never have children, you know, because your body has gone through so much. You're not going to have children. She says, I had my children. And they said, now your career is over. Now you're a mother. Now you don't have a career. She says, I won my Olympic medal after I had already had two children. And I have awesome. So many more medals after that. So this is a thing, you know, why I write nonfiction is because I want these stories, real life stories, to come to the universe, to be heard by more people so that we can all take hope and inspiration for them. You know, I think, and this is just my opinion, that much as I would love to write, fiction, I think fiction actually gives us an escape into a different world. It, you know, when you want to escape your worlds. Can you hear me?
Now I can.
Yeah. So I would say that, you know, if somebody were to tell me about fiction and nonfiction, I would say that fiction gives hope. You know, fiction gives hope to people. Fiction holds up examples, shining examples of what the human spirit is capable of. And we can all take inspiration from these stories. Nonfiction gives a welcome break to all of us. To go into another world, live in the world that the author has created, you know, even if it is for a brief few hours, you still get to live life vicariously. So fiction is amazing. But for me, nonfiction is even more amazing because these are real stories, flesh and blood, people who have risen above their challenges and lived, showed us what exemplary lives we can lead.
Awesome. Really awesome, Sudha. And the best part is that helping so many people write about their lives, their experiences, their dreams. You have helped your mother write a book, and you also children to write. You have these writing workshops in the park where you write and the children write along with you. It's amazing. Do tell us about these writing workshops, these Get Writing and Writing for Women initiatives that you have.
I think those are the bonuses that my writing life or my being author gives me. You know, like I said to you, for an author, meeting people, meeting readers, all of this is like a lifeline. You know, what are authors if their books are not read by people who love books? You know, so authors love people. For me, also there is this thing that I always have said that we all are walking, talking museums of memories. And we all have stories inside us. You know, each person has a story to tell. The difference between an author or a writer and everybody else is that an author knows how to bring out those things, you know, use words to make a beautiful story, and somebody else might not. Can you hear me? You seem to. I think there is a connectivity issue. So, yes. So 10 years ago, when I wrote my first book, Leading Ladies, and as I set out on this sort of book promotion tour, so I went from city to city, various cities, smaller towns, and wherever I went at a book launch or wherever I met readers, there would be at least one person who would tell me, you know, ma'am, this happened to me, or this happened to my family, or, you know, I have this idea that I want to write, but ma'am, I don't know how to write. So how do I write? And when enough people had told me about this, I said, this here is an opportunity, isn't it? That there are so many people who want to write, but they don't have a clue how to write. They don't know how. Most people are intimidated by the thought of writing, you know, because the way we have been taught to write in school is very basic. And it's you know, we write that very basic school essays, and then you grow up, and then you spend your lifetime in within four walls in an office writing some official documents. There is nothing creative in any of that. So to write creatively is a craft. There are tools, and there are ways you write. There are techniques to it. And I said that I want to help people to write their stories. And so my first writing workshop, Get Writing, was held, in 2010, in 2011. And so many people, so many of my friends told me, why do you want to start something like this? You know, you are a writer, you're a respected writer. Why do you want to spend your time doing something else? And I said, because I have written this book, I know that it is so important for people to want to write their stories, to help them to write their stories, to give them the tools. What they do with it later is dependent on them, but let me at least equip them with. And I started Get Writing. The first edition of Get Writing was held in Pune. 45 people came. And for that, for 11 years ago in Pune, which is a very conservative market, for 45 people to, you know, the room filled up with 45 people. The rest I had to send back saying, I'm sorry, I'll hold one soon, but I don't have the place now. And I have been holding this writing workshop now for over 10 years. And it has given me the kind of joy that very few other things have given me, because then they go home and then they start writing. And some of them write to tell me that writing has healed them. Writing about the things that have tortured them have healed them. Writing about the things that are important to them, writing that has helped them regain their joy. You know, they have rediscovered themselves with writing. Some of them have written little books. Some of them have self-published. Some of them write for themselves. They say, I don't want to publish my book, but I want to write because it is important for me to discover myself. And and writing in the park was actually something that came up to me. Hello?
Yeah, that's really wonderful.
I started writing in the park because over the last few years, I've been seeing our children spend far too much time on gadgets. They're all indoors, they're not going out, they're on their phones, and they're not, even if they're reading, they're not reading enough. And I said that there has to be a way we get our children out into the open and, you know, commune with nature and discover the joys of simple living instead of being surrounded by all the things that, you know, people like us, people of privilege, we give our children too many things. And so they lose out on the little joys of being out in the open and playing and climbing a tree, all of those things. So I just announced, just for a lark, I said, I'm holding Pune as a very, very beautiful, over 150-year-old park, the Empress Garden, it's called. It's beautiful. It's full of trees. And it's an amazing green lung for the city. And I said, on so-and-so date, I'm conducting writing in the park for children who are interested to write with me, come along. And I think some 25, 30 children came. We spent the entire day sitting under the tree and just talking about books. And I get them writing exercises, and they wrote stories, and it was so much fun. And the children actually noticed, you know, I made them write about what they were seeing around them and weave stories around that. And I think I learned more from that workshop than the children learned, because, and they learned how beautiful it is to be under the sky, to see, you know, to see trees and a little, you know, stream running by, and it was so amazing. And now what I do is, anybody who has a green space and, you know, who want to do something different, I tell them, give me your garden for a day, or give me your garden for a couple of hours, and I will bring children and we ride together. And children love it. You know, it's just that we have not taken them to a park. We find it easier to take them to a mall, you know. So when you take them to a park, when we take them to a park, they look around, they commune with nature. There is a joy in that, you know, for touching the leaf of a plant, picking up a little twig, playing with it, writing about it. How does it feel to hold a twig in your hand? You know, what are the feelings? What is the texture like? Children actually then love to do all of those things. We just have to find ways to get our children back to books and to writing. So one of the things is this. This is how I do it. And the most fulfilling part of my writing workshops has been my writing with women, you know, initiative. I started this about four years ago. I started noticing that in my writing workshops, when everybody else went away at the end of the class, you know, I have an entire day's workshop. So by 5:30 p.m. when we finish, there'll always be one woman or a couple of women who would struggle, and they would stay back while everybody left. And then say, ma'am, can I speak to you? And I would say, yes. And she would say, very shyly, with a lot of diffidence or, you know, uncertainty, she would say that, you know, when I was 22-year-old, this thing happened to me. And today, for the first time in my life, I wrote about it. And I didn't have the courage, because in my writing workshops, I ask people to share, stand up and read what they have written, because that's also part of the process, isn't it? To own your story, to own your idea. So yes. So she said, I didn't have the courage, or I didn't feel good, you know, reading this, because there are men in this class and I felt uncomfortable. And it happened so often that I realized that women in our country really, you know, even if it's on a macro level, women in our country really don't have a platform where they can voice an opinion or talk about the things that concern them, talk about the things that have given them grief or given them joy or whatever. Just, they are not asked for their opinion. They are not given a platform oftentimes. And I said, this can't be, you know, because this woman has a story and she deserves the right. She deserves to be able to stand up and talk about that story, write about it with confidence. And so I said, I want to give a safe haven, a safe place for women where they can come together and write about their lives, talk about the things that they want to write about, you know, share their experiences. And I started it 3 years ago, and it has given me so much joy, because when women come to this workshop, they write about their innermost things, the things that most concern them. And they find so much safety in, you know, being around other women. And they talk, they share their stories, they find a universality about what's happening. They say, they realize that, oh, this has not happened just to me, it has happened to you also. And then what I see is also beautiful sisterhood forming there. You know, the women become friends, you write together, you share your experiences, you become friends, and you become your support systems. Even after the workshop is over, they are friends, you know, they are in touch with each other. And that gives me joy. And I think when women write, it is not just a writing, they're not just writing about themselves. They're writing about, through their writings, we actually come to know about gender dynamics, society's development at that particular point, at that point about which she's writing, her status in society, her status in her family. There are so many things that you come to know when a woman writes her story. So I think that is a really important thing that I'm doing. It gives me immense joy.
Lost you again. Oh, I think we should take just a minute, Sudha, because you see, you are saying such precious stuff, and I think a lot of it is getting lost because of connectivity issues. And but I really, let us figure this out.
We can do the last bit once again. And what I'll suggest is, you know, we can shift the location. I'll just give me 2 minutes.
Should we?
We'll have you shift the location to a different network so that.
All right.
Now, I mean, till the end, we will not lose any connection. So just give me a moment. Sudhaji, please just wait. Right. We're towards the end of the session, right?
No problem.
Right. Okay. सर अभी चेक करिएगा हाँ अभी मेरे हिसाब से तो रहेगा मैंने स्टैटिक आई भी दे दिया इसको यस दिस शुड स्टे नाउ सो Can we just do the last bit, once again, please?
About writing workshop, women's writing.
Yes, that was very important piece, and that should be captured once again. Yeah.
Okay. Would you, Siddharth? You were listening to us. So tell me, do you want me to ask the question again, or was that clear?
No. I mean, let's do that from the question only once again. Okay. You can ask the question, and then we start the session again. Yeah.
So, Sudha, you have been conducting these writing workshops for the last 10 years, even when they were unheard of. And you have had, people, children in the park, you have written with them, you've helped them to write. You have helped your own mother to write a book. And so do tell us about your writing initiatives, the Get Writing and Writing for Women initiatives.
Okay. Why I started my writing workshops. So I think, when I wrote my first book in 2010, when I went on a book tour to promote that book, wherever I went, in smaller towns, in bigger cities and bookstores, in airport bookstores, there would always be somebody who would come and tell me, ma'am, this thing is something I want to write about. This happened in my family and I want to write about that. But I don't know how to write. And this happened so often that I realized that there are so many people who want to write, but they haven't a faintest clue about how to do that. Because the way we are taught to write in school, or at least the way we were taught when we were in school, was just to write, very basic essays, compositions, and then we grow up and then we spent our entire life with the four walls of an office and write very boring, very important, officious documents. But we are not doing any creative writing. We are not writing to express ourselves or to tell a story. And so I said, I want to teach people how to write, because I think, I believe that we are all walking, talking museums of memories. We all have a story within us and those stories deserve to be written. And so in 2011 Jan, I announced my first writing workshop in Pune. It was unheard of. There was no such concept in India at that point. And a lot of my friends told me, you know, you shouldn't destroy your credibility like this. Who wants to come and learn to write? And this is Pune and it's a conservative place and nobody's going to spend money wanting to write. And I said, I'm going to do it. Even if one person comes, I will teach him or her how to write. But I want to do this because I know there is this need. And 45 people wrote with me that day. You know, the youngest was 8 and the oldest was 80. And we had the most amazing time writing together. You know, I think all of us can write. But it is all about, like we say that writers are born. And yes, some writers are born. But writing is also like everything else, something that can be learned. You need the right technique. You need the right, you know, you need to learn the craft. You need to practice the craft. And for the last 10 years, that is what I've been doing, you know, teaching people how to write. And it gives me so much joy that some of them are now bloggers. Some of them have self-published their books. Some of them have actually published that in the traditional way and become quite, good writers. And some of them who say that, there are even now people who come back to my workshop every time I announce it because they say it's such joy to be in a workshop with you because we learn something new from you every time. So it is just, writing is also about community. You know, you learn in a community, you teach each other how to write. So that workshop, one of the biggest and the most joyous things about my writing workshops, like my mother workshop is called Get Writing. That's a mixed group. Men and women come there. But I started 3-4 years ago something called Writing with Women. And that is one of the most joyous, most fulfilling things I have done in my life to date in my 54 years. You know, and it came about by chance because every time I announced one of my Get Writing workshops, there would always be, you know, at the end of each workshop, you know, the workshop would go until 5:30 p.m. There would always be a couple of women who would stay back and say that, you know, I wrote about this today, but I didn't have the courage to stand up and read this out like you want us to do because there were men in that, in the workshop and I'm not comfortable or I don't have the courage or, you know, whatever. And I realized, you know, this happened so many times that I realized that women in our country really don't have a platform, you know, where they can talk about the things that concern them, share their experiences. Nobody asks a woman for her opinion on things. And this is, you know, even at a macro level, not just writing, even at a macro level, women have to fight for a platform to voice an opinion. You know, women have to really, or if you don't ask for it, you don't get it. So I said that I want to create a platform in my writing workshop where it is just a safe space for women to come together and write their stories, you know, to talk about their experiences, share their experiences, stand up and get the confidence, you know, confidently stand up and share their idea and say, this is what I believe in. And, you know, magically, I have seen that happen in my Writing with Women workshops. You know, when they come in the first, you know, in the morning, women are, they stick to themselves, they are shy, they don't know what to expect in the workshop. By lunchtime, they're already friends, you know, they're making little friendships. By the end of the class, they have formed the friendship, they have become each other's support systems. And it is the joy of my life that I know when they leave my class, they have become friends even outside. They keep in touch, they meet, they write together. And they are each other's, you know, they look to each other for support. And I think that is why writing with women for me is very important also because when a woman writes her story, she's not just writing her story. Through her story, we can come to know the maturity of a society. What is the development stage of the society? What are gender dynamics like in that society? What is her status? What is a woman's status in her family, in the society? There are so many things that she reveals through her stories. And it's important that we allow them that platform, that they get that platform, you know? And I think I made a difference with this because now I see, because I also talk about gender and diversity at corporate houses, this is one of the workshops that I'm invited to conduct in a lot of corporate houses and educational institutions, because they, you know, a lot of corporates are well-meaning. They want to do something to empower their women. They want to do things that will like upskill them or give them confidence. And one of the ways they do it is by allowing their women that platform to come together and just enrich their lives by writing. So it gives me great joy to do this. And, you know, the cherry on the cake, the icing on the cake is that I taught my mom to write her story. You know, 4 years ago, my father passed away and my mother went into deep depression. And at some point, we were fearful of what would happen to her. And then one day when I was preparing for a writing workshop, she was at home with me and she said, "What are you doing?" And I said, "I'm preparing for my writing workshop." She said, "What do you do in the workshop?" And I said, "I teach people how to write." So she said, "Do you think I can write? Will you teach me how to write?" And I said, "Of course, I will teach you how to write." And for that next 3 weeks that she was visiting me, we would sit in the afternoon and I would teach her the technique and I'd teach her. We would both write together. And sometimes she would say, "I can't do this. You know, you are trained and I can't do it." And I would say, "No, well, let us just write." And we would keep writing. And the miracle of the entire thing is that in 1 year, you know, my father's first death anniversary, she published a book of her journey with him. And it was, you know, it was such a fulfilling thing for me to know, because my mother actually discovered herself as she started writing her story with my father. She had spent 60 years with him being just his shadow, you know. And when she was writing the story, she realized her own strength. She realized what her life and her role was in that family, how she had actually empowered my father to follow his dream, and how she had empowered her 4 children by allowing us all the things that we wanted. And, you know, that, so she realized that she thought that she was just a woman who couldn't go to college and couldn't work because she was raising children. While writing that story, she realized the importance of what she had done for the entire family. And I think it is important for all women, all of us actually, to write our stories, but especially women, because far too many women think they are not worth much. They devalue themselves subconsciously, you know, so it's important.
So true, so true. And it's amazing how you have helped women by equipping them with tools of the trade, because you see, this is a platform for self-expression, which is so important. It has a therapeutic value. And so you have actually shown them the way and what counselors do for restoring balance. You have done that by your writing workshops. It's beautiful. And it's
healing. Writing heals you.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I can see that. I can see the therapeutic value of writing, just as other arts, music and art has. So like, writing is also a creative pursuit. And it's not surprising at all that your works have been translated into so many Indian languages. I think 10 to be precise. And so they are being...
progress, yes.
Yeah. So... do you have readership in other countries as well?
Yes, you know, happily, yes. And I think that is the wonder of the World Wide Web and internet, internet. I think that has made us all a sort of, it's now really truly a global village, and e-books and audiobooks and all of that have, I think, helped, you know, it has helped authors to get readership across the world. And it is a source of joy when somebody is sitting, in a small village somewhere in Germany or in the United States will write to you saying that I read this book and it's amazing and it gave me a strength. It changed the way I'm looking at the world. And so much as we authors will say that, we'll sometimes script that technology takes away a writer's space, because we lose ourselves in, instead of writing, we are spending time online and, squandering our time. But what I also want to say is that technology has helped us get, you know, break barriers like that and make our books accessible to so many people who'd otherwise not read your books.
Absolutely, absolutely. So do you think literature from India can make a mark at a global level?
Of course, we already are making so much of a mark outside. I mean, some of our books are celebrated by the entire world. We are walking away with some of the biggest writing prizes, literary prizes in the world.
Yes.
I think that there is so much more. I think there is so much more that we can do, you know, in terms of making our books and literature more celebrated, you know, and I think we would do that. We could do that very effectively if we are just able to treat our regional language literature and writers with a little more respect, you know, for want of a better word. But I do think that there is very little done. I don't know who are the people who will do it, but I think if each of us does a little bit, it'll work. But I truly think that there is so much, you know, our regional literature is a treasure trove. But in terms of making it more accessible to, you know, readers across the world, unfortunately, we have begun to think that we are all English language writers only, you know. So, and unfortunately, the world also consumes, you know, writing in English. So what I think we can also do is to encourage, one, of course, make it more sustainable, make it more monetarily viable for regional language writers to continue writing. I know so many regional language writers, even journalists, who have given up writing because there is just no money in writing. You know, no matter how much we think of writing as something which is only about passion, but writers have to pay their bills too. Writers have to still feed their families. So writers need to have some money. And that, I think that the publishing industry should listen to and make sure that, you know, English language writers themselves struggle to, you know, I don't think any English language writer other than the big top 4 or 5 who get mega bucks, most of us shouldn't give up our day jobs to just write because it's not sustainable. The case is even worse for regional language writers. They cannot live on what they get out of writing their beautiful stories, but it's almost for free. What we can also do is to make translation a more viable thing. You know, there is too little money in translating. So some amazing translators have stopped translating books because they say, this doesn't help me pay my bills. So they work for large corporate houses and make big money. So, you know, so all the little things that will make writing a sustainable thing to do will help get you encourage the regional language writers to continue writing. You encourage translators to translate that into English and German and whatever languages that the world is reading in. And I think it is not hard. It just requires commitment and requires money. It requires publishing to put money there, you know.
Absolutely. At this juncture, Sudha, I think it'll be apt to mention that Rabindranath Tagore University has done a lot to promote regional literature. I think Siddharth would be a better person to talk more about it in detail, but yeah. I can say it with conviction that they have actually promoted regional literature in a big way by encouraging writers, by giving them a platform and a forum for expression and providing them publicity as well as, so they have done, made a big contribution. And I am really grateful to the organizers of Vishwarang to have afforded me this opportunity to be speaking to you. It has been definitely an honor to be meeting you and listening to you, Sudha. Had the times been normal, you would have visited our beautiful city of lakes. And I hope, yes, you must definitely come to our beautiful Bhopal. So on behalf of the organizers of Vishwarang, and the Rabindranath Tagore University. I thank you for this very beautiful conversation. It has been very, very enriching listening to you, Sudha. And I think it's been a learning experience. I go back inspired, enriched, motivated. Thank you so much.
Thank you very, very much for having me over. It was lovely talking to you. And I'm glad that Vishwarang is doing so much for regional language literature. And I do hope that other literary festivals take something out of your books, and practice there, because I don't see that enough. Other literature festivals are just a giant celebration of English language writing. And if you can do it, so can everybody else. So I hope that you are leading by example, and I hope that everybody else takes a lesson from this. So thank you for organizing something like this. And thank you so much for inviting me to talk at your event.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dr. Sulbha, Sudhaji. It was a fascinating session. So enriching, so inspiring, so motivating. And what a wonderful note to finish this on, by getting the entire debate back to the focus back on the regional literature, the need to promote and preserve and encourage regional literature and the writers. And also, coupled with that, the need to encourage the translation work, because translation is the window with which we can really, send the message of our beautiful regional literature writings to the entire world. So it was a thoroughly wonderful session. There were many highlights, right from instilling, the need to instill the habit of reading in early years, to being a voracious reader and the impact of this in one's life, taking the plunge and answering your calling at a later stage of your career, writing passionately on things and issues which matter, not taking life too seriously also, at the same time narrating inspiring stories of real life women heroes, to the entire beautiful movement of not just being an author, but taking this movement of writing to children and several other women, and letting them a way of release, a way of expressing themselves, of their feelings and the thoughts which are caged in their hearts and in their minds. And finally, as a father of a daughter, there are many takeaways for me also from this session. So thank you for inspiring us. That was Sudha Menon, moderated by Dr. Sulbha Dixit at the Vishwarang, the Tagore International Festival for Literature and Arts 2020. We are celebrating this festival virtually this time across 16 countries. And that was Sudha Menon on her inspirations, on her writing styles, on what inspires her to write prolifically on women and other issues. And we look forward to having Sudha Menon back with us next time in person at Vishwarang. So till then, enjoy the remaining sessions. Up next, we have two tracks coming up on Vishwarang. Track one with the session on Tagore and Gandhi, and their philosophies, their sensitivities, and their perspectives. And track two will feature world poetry sessions by leading poets from across the world. So thank you so much. Stay tuned with Vishwarang. Namaskar.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. So I think, that was great and really wonderful. I would apologize once again for the technical glitches to both of you.
Yeah, we are all victims of the same internet glitches. So it's okay. No worry about it. But it is lovely. Thank you so much for having me over for this. And next year, I'm hoping we live in a better, safer world. I would love to come and be at Bhopal at the festival.
Yes,
you definitely must. You definitely must, Sudha.
Do let me know when it goes live on the 22nd.
Yes, yes. I am going to share the festival detailed schedule on mail right away.
Okay.
And some of the other creatives also, and you would find the session there. Everything is going to be premiered on the YouTube channel of Vishwarang.
Okay.
So if you just follow that, you will get all the automated reminders from there.
Lovely. Thank you so much. You have a good day and enjoy the festival. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you, Rijansh. Thank you, Raman.
Thanks, Rijansh.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.